Hello and welcome to episode 27 of the Stanford MLSys seminar series. My name is Dan Fu. Today we have with us Fyodor, Piero, and our guest Even Oldridge. So today Even is going to be talking to us about how NVIDIA supports recommender systems. So as usual, there will be a 30-minute talk followed by a podcast where the audience can ask questions. But before we get to that, just a quick reminder, you can always find our schedule on our website, mlsys.stanford.edu, and subscribe to our channel, subscribe to our mailing list, and you should get updates every week. So a little bit about our speaker today, Even. So Even is a senior manager at NVIDIA, leading the effort to develop the Merlin open source libraries. He has a PhD in computer vision and a master's in programmable hardware from the University of British Columbia. He's worked in the recommendation space for the past decade and is an industry co-chair for the ACM RecSys Conference 2021. And as I mentioned, today he's going to be talking to us a little bit about how NVIDIA supports deep learning and recommender systems in production. So Even, go ahead and take it away.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I'm super excited to be a part of this. The MLSys seminar series is an awesome group of amazing talks, and I've really enjoyed it. I'll be referencing a few of my favorites over the period. Today we're here to talk about one of my favorite subjects, recommender systems. It's an area that I've kind of dedicated my life to. There's a lot of very interesting aspects, and obviously in a half hour talk, there's a limited number of things that we can cover. So I'll try and cover as much as we can, and I'm hoping there'll be some good questions from the audience, and anyone's free to reach out after the fact. There's a number of ways to reach me. But first, I kind of wanted to walk through, at a high level. I'm guessing most people understand, what recommender systems are at this space, but really, I think it's important to acknowledge how ubiquitous they are. Recommender systems, really, they are the engine of the internet. There's so many things that you do every day that are influenced by recommender systems. And it's a massive, massive sort of model space, compute market. And I think one of the things that sort of struck me as I was preparing for this talk is, a lot of the talk online around recommenders is around recommender models. And I think the system aspect of recommender systems is a lot of, it really is an MLSys type task. And there's a lot of complexities that the group here is probably well-versed in. And so I think there's a lot of interesting challenges on tool interoperability and how to build a holistic system that really, serves recommendations into production. But I think first it's important to start kind of at the recommender models. And I think for those who aren't familiar, when you're deploying deep learning recommender models, recommender models aren't the same as computer vision models or NLP models. And I'll highlight a few of the key differences. But with the computer vision models, you can see the bulk of the model is the model itself. It's the weights, it's the parameters that are required for training those weights. And the input to the model is an image. It's sort of a larger block of vectorized information that gets fed through that model and processed to produce some sort of classification task, regression task. The tasks vary significantly, right? For NLP, we start to see this concept of embeddings and things within the space represented as their own kind of numerical representation. It's sort of an embedding is like a cheeky sort of one hot lookup compute optimization, but they become so ubiquitous in NLP and in RecSys that they become kind of their own thing as a mental model. And so embeddings here in this context represent a vocabulary. So each of those sort of 30,000 vectors of 1024 long represent a word, and each word is sort of fed through the model in sequence in order to generate some sort of representation that you're trying to learn. Sometimes the task is to predict the next word in the sequence. Sometimes the task is to summarize the sequence. There's a bunch of different kind of aspects to that problem space. And those embeddings are sort of direct memory lookups in a way, but they don't make up the majority of the model. Like when you really think about the sort of the overall scope of the model, transformer models, and especially the more recent models, they're billions of parameters large. And so still the vast majority of the representation or the space being taken up on the device that's doing the compute is in that sort of compute aspect. It's not in the memory aspect. And when you get to recommender systems, you start to see a bit of an inversion in that context. And so, you know, the embeddings for users and the embeddings for items. If you think about like for a recommender system, what you're doing, you're trying to take for a given user and sort of based on their context, and for a given item based on the context of the item in terms of where it's being shown, is that item a reasonable choice for the user? Is that, you know, is this an item we should recommend to the user or not? And that's sort of a binary framing of the problem. There's other ways to frame it that are more like language modeling, where you're trying to say, okay, given the sequence the user's predicted or the user's interacted with, what's the next one they're going to interact with? But in both of those situations, you typically have this sort of representation of the user as an embedding and a representation of the item as an embedding, and potentially user context and item context as well. If you have hundreds of millions of users, hundreds of millions of items, that means that you've got these, you know, these massive, massive embedding tables. And those embedding tables really are like they're pure memory lookup. And the models themselves tend to be more on the small side, right? Like a few layers of MLPs, a few layers of transformers, but they're not the NLP style transformers that are very wide and very deep. They're, you know, 3-5 layers deep, and they're much narrower, right? And so, you know, you see a significant difference in that aspect, and that leads to some disconnects in the way that sort of some of the deep learning tools and some of the deep learning hardware that was developed in the age of computer vision, when everything was these big images, like there's a bit of a disconnect in terms of that task, right? And so, you know, part of what I've been working on and working with NVIDIA on is like, how do we update the hardware? How do we update the software to align with those differences in the tasks, and to make really like to make recommender systems on GPU more efficient? And that's sort of the NVIDIA aspect of it. But I'm, you know, broadly interested in recommender systems as a whole. The main takeaway from this, though, is that recommender models are very memory intensive, right? The item embeddings, the user embeddings, those are generally the sort of the constraints or the bottlenecks. And if, you know, we'll talk about kind of how that memory fits on GPU and that aspect of the problem space. But if you look historically, you know, the out-of-the-box performance of the RecSys models on GPU was, you know, I mean, I'll say poor. That's a kind of a personal opinion. I was doing this, you know, a long time ago. And if you look, you know, over 5 years ago, 6 years ago, like you'd get a 4 to 5x perf boost, but the GPUs cost 5 to 10x more than the CPUs you were using. So it didn't really make sense to do that. And you know, at the time, I really didn't understand why. It was, you know, a GPU is designed to do compute. And I didn't realize that, you know, really this is about like memory bandwidth and available memory and the memory efficiencies. And so, you know, the out of the box kind of performance back then, it just didn't work for everybody, and so, you know, we've come a long way. And I think the first talk I want to highlight is Sarah Hooker's amazing talk on the sort of hardware software, or the hardware lottery. She framed it, I would say, you know, like hardware software lottery, and really like recommender systems were a victim of that in a way, right? And I think, you know, what we get to now, and being somebody who works on the software side within a hardware company, I mean, NVIDIA is both a hardware and a software company. And so, you know, what we're doing is hardware software co-design at this stage. And that's like immensely satisfying, because you can take the problem space and really understand what's going on, and then kind of work with the hardware teams to resolve that. And in many cases, they're way ahead of us. You know, like these problems exist in multiple fields. And you know, and so we've been working with the hardware teams, but the hardware teams have been, you know, been providing these solutions. And I think, like, if you look at the last generation, the A100s that came out, you know, in last year, like the amount of memory has gone from, you know, 8, 10, 11 gigs of memory to like 80 gigs with the most recent A100s, right? So that amount of memory available on the GPU is massive. The other thing that's grown massively is the memory bandwidth, and that, like, the access to that memory and the memory access patterns. Like, if you think about those embeddings, your embeddings, like, when you're pulling data from them, it is just a memory lookup. So your memory bandwidth is the bottleneck. If you're doing that memory lookup on CPU and then transferring the data to GPU, then you have to think about IO, and there's a bunch of other constraints there. And so there's a lot of kind of complexities around this. And so what we're trying to do is take advantage now of these new hardware solutions that have sort of much, much more memory. So an A100 has 80 gigs of memory and, you know, 1.8 terabytes of memory bandwidth. So that's like, you can really hammer that memory if you access it in the right way and pull way more data and implement models way more efficiently. And then as you scale to DGX A100 things, you know, the interconnect becomes important, and how those A100s are communicating with each other, that aspect of it becomes important. But again, that's an area that, you know, that's been thought about, and there's like 4.2 terabytes of interconnect in a DGX A100 between all of the GPUs. And then as those scale, you know, when the A100, they're interconnect through a NIC now, but they're connecting across multiple nodes. And that 1.6 terabytes in the final stage, that can be, you know, 1.6 per node between the nodes, or that can be 1.6 terabytes per second into, you know, like network memory, which is another interesting kind of aspect that's more recently been explored with GPU direct storage. And I don't cover that, you know, in this talk. We can talk about it at the end. But really, like the key here is that, you know, memory bandwidth is the bottleneck when you're on GPU. Interconnect bandwidth and IO is the bottleneck when you're off of GPU. When it comes to like basically providing the you know, thousands or hundreds of thousands of cores that are on the GPUs with enough compute to really, you know, fire on all cylinders and operate efficiently. So data availability is really the key to better performance. And that sort of stems from the difference in performance. Like for the GPU memory into the GPU processor cores, you know, there's hundreds of gigabits to terabytes per second memory bandwidth, right? As soon as you're kind of stepping back into CPU memory and transferring, now you're down to tens of gigabits per second. And when you're going from, you know, from RAID or storage up to CPU memory, it's in the gigabits per second. And so, you know, the further down the chain you go, the less performance you get. The GPU direct storage is actually a nice kind of bypass here that lets you go kind of straight into GPU memory in that way, through your NICs. So There's tools and technologies being developed that are basically designed to optimize the, you know, the solutions for getting the data onto the GPU. And once the data is on the GPU, it performs really well. And that's, you know, that's awesome. And it's important because those data sets that we're talking about, those user embeddings, those millions of users and items, like that's the majority of the model, right? And so you've got to be accessing that efficiently. And the biggest complaint or challenge that I run into when I'm talking with people is, you know, and I used to run into this myself, is my users and items don't fit on the GPU. This model is just not going to fit. And so, you know, we've developed a lot of solutions really to help scale across multiple GPUs. And there's, you know, one of the teams that I work with, the huge CTR team, has developed awesome technology for kind of scaling to multi-GPU and multi-node and doing the embeddings that way. So, you know, that's effective, and that's really, you know, and that's really beneficial and powerful. And you can see in the last ML perf benchmark, you know, which in NVIDIA for the RecSys side of things had the, you know, the best performing commercial solution. And I think we were able to train, I mean, our solution for training Criteo, which is a 1.2 terabyte data set with 4 billion examples. I think we do the pre-processing for it in 3 minutes, and we train it in 2.5 or 3 minutes. Like it's getting kind of ridiculous for the scale of data that exists, you know, which is good. It's great news. But you don't always want to have to scale up with the cluster. And you know, it's pretty expensive to scale up a DGX. You know, if all you're using it for is the memory, really, then, you know, then that maybe doesn't make as much sense. And so, you know, there's some other considerations that we can take into account. And this is, you know, one of those nice things about the RecSys space is when you look at, and this is sort of the distributions or cumulative distributions of like the percentage of items interacted with, you know, over the course of the data set. And what you see, and this is if you're familiar with this, it's like a Gini coefficient. So essentially, like you're, you know, in the numbers along there. And it's a representation of like how imbalanced is that data set in terms of the like the smallest percentage of users getting the highest percentage of interactions, right? Or items in this case. And you can see that, you know, the RecSys datasets, they generally follow this power law distribution. They're like a very small percentage of users or items are interacting with a very small percentage, you know, like a small percentage of users interacting with a small percentage of items at the heart of the dataset. And so, you know, the users also follow this pattern. And because of this, we can kind of think about ways to access data or access this efficiently, right? One of those ways is like when you're training, you can kind of split up the data set and say, okay, well, we're gonna figure out for the first quarter of the data set, what are all the embeddings that we need? And we're gonna load those into the GPU. And while we're training on the GPU, we're gonna figure out the next set of embeddings that we need. And then, you know, when that training is finished, we'll just do a swap in GPU memory. And this is very different from accessing the data on the CPU, you know, one at a time. You're loading a huge chunk of memory all at once. You're basically like flushing the cache and putting the new data in the cache. You can do this in training because you know, or you can pre-calculate exactly what embeddings you're going to need. And this lets you train much, much faster without having to have all of your space or all of your embeddings in memory. Right. And so this helps in the training situation and helps solve the problem in that context. And that's, you know, that's a really beneficial technology. When it comes to, you know, the inference side of things, and when you've got, you know, user requests coming in, you don't know what they're going to be requesting, right? And so you can't really get away with that, but you can do the same thing in the sense that you can, you know, you can cache hot the hot items and cache the hot users and keep them in the GPU embedding space or keep them in the embedding cache on the GPU. And when you have to, you can go off GPU onto a parameter server that kind of pulls that data in and handles the cache misses. And, you know, you can kind of process it in that way. And these are technologies that, you know, that the team at NVIDIA is working on kind of generalizing and making it more kind of more accessible and more readily available and trying to, you know, provide more access, more flexibility for people who want to build recommender systems on GPU without having to, you know, to scale up their system into this massive super node, you know, when their data doesn't fit. And I think, you know, there's benefits and ways to balance. And you can see in this instance, like we've got, you know, on the GPU, you can have an embedding cache. If the models that are on that GPU share an embedding space, they can all share that same embedding cache. And so you can, you know, leverage and benefit from that. And similarly, you know, if the GPUs that are on a single node, like a DGX A100 or some other sort of CPU instance can share that parameter server. And we're working on ways to kind of distribute the parameter server off across multiple CPUs and that aspect of it. So far, all I've been talking about is that sort of that first class, that first part of recommender models. And that's a big part of what the team does is like make sure that recommender models train efficiently on GPUs, that, you know, that there's a really straightforward, easy to use API that lets you kind of do that training, do that acceleration, do everything you want to do. And the sort of the methodology we target is kind of describe what you want to do, not how you do it and not how to scale it. And, you know, there's a lot of work that goes into that I'm not going to cover today, but you know, we're here to talk a little bit more about recommender systems, right? And I think most of the information on recommender systems online is really focused on this modeling aspect. So I wanted to take the time here to spend a little bit of time digging into, like, I mean, this is a view or like one example of what an online recommender system might look like. And we'll go into the details and kind of answer the questions of like why the tools are needed. So, you know, we've gone from like this very simple diagram of just the training to this much more complex diagram. And I'll walk through it because I think it's, you know, it overwhelms even me when I look at it. And this is getting more into the heart of the systems side of things, right? But let's see here. Yeah. So, you know, the first stage when you're thinking about a recommender system and building things is, okay, we've got this sort of this front end over here that we're getting requests from, and there's some sort of interaction from the user, and we're going to record that interaction in the data lake. And then that same kind of training loop with the data scientists or the machine learning engineers who are kind of coming up with the new models, coming up with the new features, coming up with the new hyperparameters. They're testing these new ideas. they're kind of iterating on that sort of weekly, monthly, whatever cycle that they have, where they're trying to come up with the best models to put into production. And then this is the first time we've got, okay, well, now we've got those hyperparameters, we've got those features, we've got those kind of those systems. Let's train something nightly, and we'll put that model into production in an inference server. And there's our kind of our model, and there's the feature transforms that have to happen, right? And you know, and one of the questions that comes up very quickly is, well, I've got millions of users and millions of items, so like lots of requests. I can't for every user compare to every item. And so you typically have these multi-stage systems where essentially you say, okay, well, from the millions of possible items, what's a good starting point for this user? And then we'll let a ranking model kind of pick from there, because it's too expensive to compute for all users across all, you know, especially as their preferences change and as these things, you know, these things, like a big part of this is a recommender system is a feedback loop, right? And so, you know, as you make recommendations, users interact with them, and they begin to kind of that begins to play out in terms of like what recommendations they're going to get next, and we'll talk a little bit about that as well. But excuse me, the first system is that we'll talk about is like a candidate generation retrieval system. And that's just essentially picking like from the millions of possible items, give me, you know, a reasonable subset that I'm then going to rank and share to the user. And that, you know, that takes the form of things like approximate nearest neighbor systems, where you've got an embedding representing the user's interests, and you're going to look into the items, and that's in item space, and you're going to look into the item space and get the nearest neighbors, and then run a more complicated deep learning model on that. You can do things like graph walks, where you kind of traverse the graph randomly and come up with the sort of the patterns of interaction there. But there's a whole range of talks that could be given on that, and I think it's, you know, it's an area that's less well known and less well studied, and a very interesting one to me and my group. The next thing that sort of begins to come about is, you know, you've got a data scientist who's like slacking the machine learning engineer, or maybe they're doing it themselves, and they're like loading the model into production on a Thursday, and then, you know, they're woken up at 2 a.m. on a Friday with a frantic call that, you know, things are broken, something's not working, why is this not going right? And like at that point, you start thinking about like, well, how do I decide if a model should be deployed into production, right? And I think that now we're getting into the heart of things that, you know, that are very like bread and butter of MLSys, right? You've got to think about things like model analysis. You got to think about things like the evaluation store. You've got to do things like look at your data that the model was trained on, look at the data that's coming into production and the distributions. And I think, you know, Josh's talk on evaluation stores was really an awesome, like it highlights the need for a centralized system there. You know, I think, you know, what he's building there is a really interesting concept. And I'm excited to see that come to fruition. And if you haven't seen that talk, I highly encourage, you know, the audience to go back and review it, because it's a really, really excellent one. But all of those kind of core ideas of like, how do we decide the models into production? How do we decide if everything is kind of working properly? You have to start thinking about that if you're building a system in production, right? And then like the model is one thing, and you can evaluate the model and evaluate the performance, but you've also got this data that's being transformed in the sort of in the three stages of like the exploration, when you're trying to figure out what features you should include, and then in that nightly training job, and then at inference time. And so there's, you know, there's ways to simplify that process. Like when I first started in the field, what I would see is like, okay, we've got this process that works like for training, and we may reuse that, or we may kind of spend some time optimizing that for the nightly. And then at inference time, often it, like the inference server might be in a completely different language or a completely different system. And there'd be this like rewrite that would have to happen, and a lot of checking that would, you know, to make sure. And you'd have to have really rigorous unit tests, and you learn the hard way. Like, and it's not so easy to see if your feature engineering, like the feature transforms can be wrong in very subtle ways that can, you know, that can break your model or make your model's performance much, much worse than a properly tuned model. And so you really need to make sure. And so one of the tools that my team's worked on and developed is this tool called NVTabular, which is sort of like an on GPU workflow for doing feature engineering and pre-processing, getting the data ready. And you can apply that in all three stages. You can apply that, you know, in your pre-processing and iterate and move quickly. You can apply that, you know, you can scale it up easily and quickly to do the nightly training. And then you can apply the same on GPU as the data flows in, or as we'll see, like the feature store aspect of this. You know, often doing that transformation to get the data ready for a machine learning model should be done in a consistent way. And feature stores are a nice way to kind of lock that down and make sure that, okay, the pre-processing that's happening to get the data ready is being done before the data hits the feature store, and both your production and your inference services are hitting that feature store to get the data in a way that's already transformed in the same mechanism, right? And so, you know, feature stores begin to become this important component of the ecosystem. But then in recommender systems especially, and this is sort of where recommender systems, I think, are a little different from some other MLSys or other machine learning models, is you really have to think about how you're going to deal with new users and new items. Like you can't, you're often not retraining that model, especially if you're not retraining nightly. Like, what do you do when a brand new user shows up? You've got to show them something. I mean, you can direct them to a different model and do something like popularity based, and that's reasonable. You can use session-based recommendation. And there's a bunch of techniques in the field that kind of solve this, but really, like, one of the core things to think about is, okay, I've got this new user, I've got this new item. When I worked at realtor.com, we had new houses or new listings coming in. And with the way the real estate market is, you've got to have those listings showing like almost immediately. And so, you know, there was timelines of like process the images to understand the categories, process the text to understand what's going on there, convert from the MLS specific format to our own internal format, and then package all of that up and get that into the data lakes. And then from there, kind of process it in a way that aligns with the machine learning models in the feature store, right? And so feature store ingest is something you begin to really think about when new users and new items come into play. And there's a lot to that. And I think, you know, again, that could be a whole half hour talk if we wanted to get into it. And then kind of as we start to get more and more complex, you know, we've got this nightly process, we've got this model that's being updated nightly, but really, like, if you've got a fast system, if you're dealing with things like news, things like, you know, user-generated content, you really need to think about how you keep that model and the features more up to date. And there's a couple of things to think about there. One is, you know, instead of hitting the data lake and then processing it nightly, you need to stick a cache in the middle there and be able to capture that data and do the processing, get that data into your sort of training jobs that are happening, you know, hourly or on the minute, or, you know, like some, and you tend to do things like, instead of retraining across the entire data set, you'll do an iterative training where you take the current model and you train it on some new data, and then that's your new model. And so there it becomes even more important to have those kind of checks and balances in place to see, like, if you're deploying a new model every 5 minutes, you want to make sure that model is really, really, you know, properly evaluated to make sure that production serving is not going haywire, right? Because it's, you know, millions, hundreds of millions, billions of dollars of business can be lost when that happens, right? And so, you know, the interaction cache plays a role. Often you want to kind of keep track of what's going on with the user, with the items, with the aggregation. Like for a news system, for example, you know, when you post an article, you want to understand the popularity of that article very, very quickly, right? And I think with user-generated content, it's the same. So you got to use like kind of live online counting systems or aggregation systems that are kind of understanding the popularity of users, the interaction of items with that. You know, and also building up online sessions, things like, okay, the user's coming and they're kind of interacting with these last few items. What's the next item? And I think that's a missing piece of the space. There's tools, kind of broader, more general tools that sort of work in this space. But, you know, like Kafka streaming and Flink and some of these kind of streaming services. But there's nothing kind of from a tooling standpoint that I know of. So if anybody, you know, on the call here is aware of that, I'd love to hear about it and kind of build a better understanding of what's going on in that space, because I feel like there's an opportunity there within that space. But really, like, the goal here is to get to the point where, you know, you've got your model being updated almost in real time, right? Like you've got, you know, the latest interactions are being fed into the model to keep it up to date, and the model is being, you know, retrained to get you, you know, the freshest possible recommendations. And then kind of the last thing we get to is, okay, that loop, all of those tools and all that technology we talked to, that's about a single model. That's just this kind of this deep learning model number one and the feature transforms for it right at the beginning. So you've got a similar system generating your candidates that you have to make sure, okay, the embedded representations of the items and that has to kind of get fit into your ANN and the system that generates that on the user side. You've got the candidate generation side for, you know, you may be using Elasticsearch or some other, you know, business logic rule-based systems. So you've got potentially tens or hundreds of these models and systems, and it just becomes, you know, that much more complex to maintain everything in production. It's definitely not an easy task. And then the last thing I'm going to talk about is, you know, really like a very deep topic is like, how do you measure that feedback loop? You're getting these interactions from users, you're showing them recommendations, and then they're interacting with the new things you're recommending, but they're only ever interacting with the things that you show. And so you have to, you know, potentially add some variance in there or some randomization. You have to, you know, think about this off policy, and really do proper logging and online and offline evaluation and the evaluation store. That gets us to like my very complex, broader recommender system. I think, you know, I've tried to walk through like the whys of what each part is. For a recommender system, all of these pieces need to work together, right? You need, and a lot of these tools are fairly new, like, you know, model analysis, evaluation stores, ambitabular, even feature stores are only a few years old, right? And so there's not really an ecosystem that pieces all these things together. And I think that's an opportunity. That's something that, you know, that my team is very cognizant of, and something we're thinking about is like, how do we build, you know, tools that interoperate in the ecosystem? How do we build tools that aren't just targeted towards data scientists who are training the models, but really think about like the machine learning engineers who are deploying the models into production after the fact, and think about, you know, the logging tools and the systems that are interacting after the fact, and how we can make sure that what we're generating, what we're doing, really aligns in that context as well. And so, you know, my team at NVIDIA is called the Merlin team. Our goal is kind of providing performant end-to-end recommender systems on the GPU. So we really, you know, I want to make sure that all of these stages work, that they work well, that they work well on the GPU, and really pushing that easy to use, easy to develop aspect of it as well. Because I think it's, you know, right now it's incredibly complex to build even like a part of these systems, and there's sort of ways of designing the APIs to make it simpler and you know, while making it more performant and end-to-end. Yeah. So, I mean, if you're interested, I know we've come to kind of the end of the talk. I've got a number of GitHub repos, probably too many at this stage. We're trying to centralize towards the NVIDIA, or sorry, that should be just NVIDIA Merlin on that top one, actually. And then we've kind of moved to that top level repo of github.com/NVIDIA-Merlin. There's NVIDIA/NVTabular, which is the ETL and pre-processing. There's NVIDIA/HugeCTR, which is our kind of scalable recommender system, and Triton Inference Server, which is the inference side of things. And we're really kind of grow things out. And yeah, and you know, we're growing the team as well. We're especially interested in interns in the space year round. If you're interested in building open source tools, that's the other aspect of this is, you know, this is all kind of open source technology that we're trying to develop here. Make it publicly available, make it so that, you know, so that everyone can contribute if they want to, if they have ideas, and we can grow this as an ecosystem and not just as a product. Like I'm very interested in kind of interoperating with the tools that exist that are already well built and thinking about that aspect of it as well. So yeah, and that's the talk.
Cool. Thanks so much. That was a really great talk. So now we're going to be starting to transition kind of into the podcast portion. So just a reminder to the audience, during this portion, feel free to submit questions in the chat, and we'll summarize and ask them to Even. So I guess I can go ahead and start here. So Even, I was reminded in the first half of your talk about a lot of the observations that Sarah was making in the hardware lottery talk that we had a couple weeks ago, and I'm really glad that you brought that talk up. I'm curious, so from your perspective, do you think that there are, what other domains may be being underserved as a result of kind of like the history or, the random walk through the hardware space that we've been taking, through like video games and, movies, the graphics to image processing and all that over the last few years?
Yeah, I think I wouldn't call it a random walk. Like, honestly, there was a very concerted effort to move into the AI space by NVIDIA. And it was very thought out. And there was, it wasn't just a, oh, hey, this also works for, there was a lot of work put into that. And I definitely don't want to trivialize that aspect of it. I think in terms of areas that are being underserved or areas that, that it's still hard. It's sort of those domains where things like the memory and the compute ratios don't line up, right? Like if you want to do heavy compute, the GPU is the way to go, right? It's when the memory and the IO and the access, are an issue. That's traditionally been the kind of the weakness of the GPU is, but if you look at the memory bandwidth and if you look at the amount of memory available on a GPU now, like you can get 80 gigs and I think it's 1.8 terabytes or 1.8 gigs per second memory bandwidth on the A100s. That's enough to fit like the biggest model you were possibly thinking of 2 or 3 years ago. And what I love about this is it's really like it scales up what you can think about doing and some of it the software really needs to catch up. I think the biggest sort of domain that I'm really aware of that I think needs some work, and I know NVIDIA is working on it, is graph neural nets. I think there's a lot of really cool things you can do with graphs, and I think a lot of overlap with recommendation space as well. We're looking into that and trying to figure out how that can be accelerated on the GPU as well. And again, it comes down to those issues of like, well, how do you maintain the graph in wherever it's going to sit, and where do can you get away with that graph partitioning and part of that partition sits in the cache and GPU memory and part of it's in further afield and that distribution of like, but you can see in the RecSys example, like, or in the hardware examples there, like we're really thinking now about the interconnect between devices and the interconnect between between systems, and that helps massively in this area. So
That actually reminds me. So one other question that I was thinking about kind of throughout the talk was, how do you get a company like NVIDIA to invest, potentially like hardware resources for like specific domains like recommender systems or graph neural nets? Or from your perspective, are the solutions kind of more on the software system side? And do you think, I think you mentioned, hardware software co-design a little bit. How does somebody who...
Yeah, I think when I first started out, I didn't have as many connections on the hardware side. And so a lot of it was just like, okay, well, what can I do with what we've got? And, what are the limitations? But as that grew and I started to meet people in the hardware space, they're very keen and interested to know what's not working, and when we start to do, especially things like the ML perf benchmark and ways where we can really clearly measure like, well, we can see exactly where the problem is when we're benchmarking something. And it became very clear that memory and memory IO was a weakness of the GPU in the older generations. And I think it's, there's potential that we could have solved that with software and focused on the caching side of things and just the IO bandwidth. But I'm glad to see there was sort of that push into the amount of memory put on the GPU as well. Cause I think it does enable new ideas and new technologies to be explored. And what excites me most in this space is like, I think, within a few years, we'll be looking at models that are orders of magnitude larger than we've been seeing previously, in the sense that like with NVTabular and the pre-processing, we can do pre-processing on GPU about 10 times faster than we were able to on CPU previously. And with the training, we've got these sort of data loaders that take advantage of passing data in an efficient way that speed, training on TensorFlow and PyTorch up for recommender systems by about 10x. And so suddenly your data can be created 10 times faster. Your model can be trained 10 times faster. You know, some people are going to use that to train their models faster, but I think a lot of people are going to go, well, now I'm going to explore, you know, a richer model. And it's one of the interesting aspects about recommender systems that's sort of very different from a lot of other ML fields is like the labeling problem in recommender systems really doesn't exist in a way. Like your service is a labeling service because people are interacting with it continuously, right? And so you've got almost too many interactions to deal with when you're at the scale of, you know, of the Facebooks and Twitters and Snaps and, you know, Baidus of the world, right? You've got these sort of huge data sets that you're then filtering and trying to figure out like what part of this data set should I be working with. And that's where things like the sort of the iterative training comes into play. And, you know, and you just take the existing model and sort of learn on the new section of the data. And it's a slightly different problem in that context. You don't have, you know, like I work a lot with people on the drive team as well. And for them, they're you know, doing self-driving cars, and data labeling is one of the biggest challenges, right? But it's like, it's a paradigm shift. You're not worried about labeling data in the RecSys space. If you've got the users, you've got the data, right? You've got too much data generally.
Actually, to follow up on this, I don't want to over-index on this hardware, software, co-design, but I think that there's an interesting aspect, which is, you know, the difference in speed of usually trying new things in those two different domains, if you want. So my question is, you know, it's pretty clear that, you know, NVIDIA has been like pushing towards integrating features in the hardware that makes it so that all these like great pieces of software like MVTabular, etc., are like more efficient and can work. My question is, what happens if tomorrow, now we have like big, also really big public data sets for recommender systems, what happens if tomorrow we discover that actually trillion parameters models are actually the way to go also for recommender systems, yeah. Right? Then, you know, the problem flips every now and then, it flips around, right? So I'm curious, how do you think about catching up, or do you think of like expecting for the future or designing for the future?
Yeah, that's really hard. And I think, you know, the hardware teams, when they're building these systems, and like NVIDIA, we're not just building, you know, GPUs anymore. There's CPUs, there's network interconnect with the Mellanox team that, you know, that joined a year ago. And it's really systems and data centers that we're thinking about building now. And so this is one of the interesting aspects that I think, you know, for me has been really rewarding and is like thinking about the whole system and not just like it actually matters where that data sits. It's not just the fact that you've got this GPU accelerator. It's, you have to think about like, if you've got a trillion interaction data set, like where does that data set live? If it's in the cloud, how do we get that data set into the GPU efficiently? Is there like, and so you have to start thinking about those caching techniques. And some of this is like is co-design, and some of this is just like really good thoughtful design on the hardware side of things, where we're able to like leverage like the GPU direct storage, for example. You know, that team, I didn't know that technology existed until it came out and kind of revolutionized the way I thought about how data gets onto the GPU. It changes it from a like loading the data through the CPU and through that path and host memory to your data can go straight from the straight over the NIC into your GPU memory. And so you can use things like cloud storage at the speed of your network interconnect, right? And so you can get 200 gigs a second access to memory that's sitting off of your device. That just suddenly the amount of memory you have access to balloons and grows massively. And so you can start thinking about systems in different ways. And I think there's a lot of effort at NVIDIA to think about that holistic system and how that system, like how all the pieces work together. And often by the time I'm getting to it, you know, there's so many design conversations going on. Like I'm one small, like very small team actually at NVIDIA. You know, there's 20,000 people at NVIDIA and the Merlin team is like 20, maybe 30 people, you know, and so like we're really like in this small space of but you know, they're having those same conversations with a whole bunch of other teams and really kind of generalizing it in a good way. You know, and so it's when I say it's hardware, software, co-design, it's like in many cases we're like, I don't know, the canary in the coal mine or like the first kind of business partner. It's, we're building software to help really, and because we're building software, we can help the hardware engineers understand where the gaps are in the software, in the hardware that they're building. And so they, you know, we can provide them with these examples, these use cases, these sort of these contexts that that let them really dive deep. And they, that, that's something that's been happening with, you know, with customers in production for years, and you know, and so that exists. But it's always, you know, it's always helpful to have teams internally that are dog fooding your, you know, your system. And I think that that's one of the roles that we play.
Definitely, that's a great answer. Thank you very much for that.
I wanted to kind of jump in there because you're talking a little bit about what these systems and models might look like in the future. So could you tell us a little bit more about, you know, the trends you're seeing, where we'll be in the next 3 to 5 years? And then maybe also kind of add to that, the pipeline you described, that was a great kind of walkthrough through recommender systems. I really like that. Where do you think will be the pain points in that pipeline, given the trends that we're seeing?
Yeah. In terms of the trends, like I'm seeing a movement, the Asia Pacific region, there's a lot of companies over there that are doing some amazing things with session-based recommenders. So session-based recommenders frame the problem slightly differently. And like a, the model that I showed and the sort of the initial description is like a binary, you know, here's a user, here's an item. Are they going to, is the user interested in interacting with that item? Session-based recommenders sort of step back and say, okay, well, let's take the sequence of things that the user's interacted with and try and predict the next thing. And it's very much like language modeling and transformers. And the cool thing is like a lot of the techniques that are applied to NLP actually apply there. And so you get some very interesting. I mean, in terms of where the systems are going, it's very hard to speculate because we're just at, like in my mind, at this inflection point where, you know, the hardware has changed so much and the software is starting to change so much that that like having access to, you know, 80 gigs of memory, let alone like 640 gigs or terabytes of memory, was just wasn't possible, you know, 2, 3, 4 years ago. And there's, you know, customers that are actively exploring this that have systems that they're deploying into production using these larger memory spaces now, and they're building, you know, massive models and getting a very, very good return for that, right? It's like for recommender systems, you know, if you improve the performance of the model by 0.1%, that can translate into millions or billions of dollars, right? And so, you know, I really do think that things are going to scale up and they're going to get, you know, they're going to get bigger, if anything. And I think the caching techniques that we're exploring and starting to develop are going to enable that sort of that level of scale for a lot, a lot more customers. It's not just going to be, you know, what my team's trying to do and really at the heart of the effort is like right now there are companies doing this. They're doing massive scale, you know, like multi GPU systems, giant models, giant data sets, but they've got 500,000 person engineering teams that are dedicated to like maintaining the infrastructure that makes this happen, developing the tools, building it all, making sure that the pipeline runs. And that's just not something that like small to mid-sized companies can do. And so we're trying to take some of those learnings, take some of those sort of technologies and generalize them, make them more accessible to the broader community, standardize some of the ideas, standardize some of the techniques, and really like get to the point where it's not a 500 person engineering team required to build that diagram. You can do it with, you know, like maybe next year you can do it with 50 and the year after that you can do it with 5 and the year after that, you know, like the data scientist is pushing a button and the model's deploying to production, right? And it's like it's hard to say how much things are going to change in that time frame, but an interesting thing to think about for sure.
Yeah, it sounds like there's so many opportunities now that software is kind of catching up to these, you know, new hardware possibilities.
There really is. And I think there's a lot of interaction between the MLOps ecosystem or the MLSys ecosystem and, you know, and the RecSys space. A lot of the tools and techniques that, you know, that apply there generally are, you know, are desperately needed within the RecSys space. And you know, they're it's the interconnect and the interaction between them, and you know, we're pushing towards an ecosystem solution because we think that, you know, it's important that all these tools play nice with each other. Right, like it's one thing to have a, you know, the most performant feature store. It's another thing if that feature store doesn't talk to your deep learning system, right? And so, you know, you've got to be able to leverage the tool in your own pipeline, and that's one of the challenges we face is like deciding, you know, what are the tools that we're building, what are we focused on, and what are the tools that we're looking into in terms of like, okay, these are potential partners in the ecosystem or systems that we're going to plug into.
I'm curious about the bubble that you had in your giant kind of recommender systems diagram about the training hourly or ASAP. I think we also had kind of a question in the audience about this as well, but you know, doing this kind of training online seems kind of especially tricky in recommender systems where not only do you have to kind of adapt to what's happening in like real life, like maybe like you mentioned, some news article pops up that suddenly everybody wants to hear about, but the thing that your model does itself could affect what the right thing it is for the model to do. So I think you spoke a little bit about this, but what do you think is kind of like the right systems support or abstractions that we need to figure out if your model is doing the right thing in a setting like this?
Yeah, I mean, so there's a few things that are sort of functional, like making sure that your data distributions are matching to the data distributions the models are trained on. The more kind of live the system is, and things like making sure the features being transformed, the data coming in hasn't changed, aspects like that, to make sure that you're not like, if you're training on that quick of a cycle, you can quickly start generating garbage that's sort of generating that cycle of garbage within your system. And so that is a thought and a danger. I think, like, honestly, the evaluation store seems like a really elegant solution in this context, in the sense that, you know, like you've got it, the more frequently you're training, the more kind of valuable something like that system becomes, in the sense that, you know, you're interacting with that system, you're continuously checking in to make sure that the things that you need to monitor are being met. You can look at the data distributions, the model output distributions, and I don't think it's not that different from any traditional kind of machine learning model. And I don't know that aspect of it changes, you know, no matter where you are in the pipe. It's just the importance of it and becomes critical. But in the sense that, you know, that this is a feedback loop, I think it gets down to, you know, different techniques for really thinking about how you're kind of tracking what was shown the user and sort of the, like, if I always show a particular item in position one, you know, that item is going to be much more likely to be clicked than sort of if it was kind of in this random shuffle or if it was, you know, not part of the set, right? And so there's this big distribution of potential, like how likely is the user to have engaged or interacted with this is related to how that item is being shown. And I think that's where things get a lot more complicated, in the sense that you need to be thinking about your UI, you need to be thinking about kind of your above and below the fold and getting into kind of a more product and like interface UX facing aspects of the system, to really be able to track and understand like the propensity and you know, there are a lot of people who are much smarter than me who are like studying this full time, that I think would be kind of better sources for it. But I think it's an important space and an important aspect to think about, especially as you begin to start training more and more frequently, for sure.
Actually, I have a little follow-up on this, which is you actually touched upon the idea of like of policy data, right?
Yeah.
And you touched upon the fact that, you know, there's potentially a huge amount of data for recommender systems, but maybe the two things are kind of a little bit in context to each other, right? You have nearly infinite amount of data, but it's all biased data.
Yeah.
all on policy data, let's put it this way, while maybe you don't have a lot of policy data, because collecting the policy data in itself is very expensive, because you were not, for instance, you should not be using the system, and so you're losing money by not using the system for collecting that. When I was working at Uber Eats, actually, on the commander system of Uber Eats, that was one issue that we had to face. I think there could be like techniques for addressing for the bias in the training side of things, but on the evaluation, that's very, very tricky. So what we ended up doing there was trying to collect off policy data for at least for evaluation. And I'm curious of your take. Do you think that that's, you know, what should we be doing with that?
Yeah, I mean, like I was saying, I'm not the expert there. And I think, you know, what you're doing sounds very sophisticated and great. I think there's a lot of research that, you know, that needs to go into that space. And it's a very interesting challenge. You know, there's like, at the end of the day, the recommender system is trying to provide, you know, good recommendations. And that means very different things to very different people. It means different things in different contexts. And ultimately, like, one of the things that makes recommender systems so interesting, but also so challenging, is like the context of a recommender system is like a human's preference, right? And you can never model that. Like, there's no way you can model a person's preference perfectly, right? You can maybe model it really well within a particular kind of framing of a context by capturing the right variables. And so thinking really hard about like, what are those variables you need to capture? Is your system even capable of capturing them? You know, do you have that information? And then, you know, I mean, there's real dangers within recommender systems, the way that they're trained, in the sense that like, a lot of recommender systems are sort of more focused on the, like, if you look at the distribution of or the prediction quality, like the users that are on the system regularly and interacting regularly, those users are like driving a lot of the training that's happening in your system. And so thinking about that long tail and thinking about like what goes on in that aspect of your kind of your underserved users, are they not interacting with your system because it's not serving their needs? And how do you kind of take that long tail and you know, push it to the side? And often the metrics that are used in this space get boiled down to a single number of like NDCG or MRR or like some single value that you're evaluating the model on and saying like, oh, well, we're higher here. So, you know, but I think when you get into model slicing, like TFMA or like TensorFlow model analysis or just model analysis in general, you can do some interesting things in terms of the slicing there. And one of the slices I really like to look at is like, you know, the like the propensity for the user to, or the number of interactions with the user, or like how frequently the user is interacting with the system, because it can tell you a lot about a model in the sense that like the model may be really well tuned for users that already exist, but it may be totally underserving new users, or it may be, I mean, you may want to be slicing across demographics and other aspects too, to really understand what's going on in terms of like why, like, and this is, you know, this begins to get into the data analytics, data science side of things. Is, you know, I think it often gets boiled down to a single number and really like understanding the distributions and the, like the distributions across multiple variables becomes a really important but really hard thing to do, right? Like this is not an easy task in any way.
Definitely, I completely agree with you on that point. Thank you very much for your answer.
Yeah, I agree, and I love the that. I think that was a great point to end on. That, you know, ultimately at the end of the day, you're trying to model a user's preference, which I don't even know my own preferences, so trying to get imagine how to do that with models and with entire systems is sounds really interesting and really challenging. Yeah, but with that, I think we're getting to the end of the hour, so I just want to thank you even for this great talk and you know, talking about all these really interesting ideas and problems. We want to say thank you to the audience for tuning in today and asking questions. As always, you can find our schedule and all our information on our website, mlsys.stanford.edu. You can go there, sign up for a mailing list, and get updates every week. You know, also subscribe to our YouTube channel. There should be a button somewhere around here that you can click. You can hit the bell icon to get notified whenever we go live every week. And next week we've got Richard Lau from Berkeley and Anyscale, and he's going to be talking about assorted boring problems in distributed machine learning. So I'm sure that will be a very fun and engaging talk. So definitely, you know, tune in for that. And yeah, with that, we'll say goodbye to the audience and thank you for tuning in.